cybersecurity? There's a ton of content out there, and if you don't know where to start, it can be overwhelming, even paralyzing. So let's fix that. Welcome to Simply Cyber, a community of tens of thousands of aspiring and active cybersecurity professionals focused on networking, knowledge sharing, and professional development. I'm Dr. Gerald, Auger, Chief Content Creator at Simply Cyber, inviting you to get the answers to your cybersecurity problems with hundreds of cybersecurity videos answering your frequently asked questions, interviewing industry experts, and live streaming daily cyber threat briefings hosted by me. Now get the stories and insights you won't find anywhere else. Hit subscribe now and dig into all the fresh content on the channel and in the community. Nothing should stop you from launching and leveling up your cybersecurity career today. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the show. Today is Tuesday, March 19th, 2024. This is episode number 581 of Simply Cyber's Daily Cyber Threat Briefing Podcast. I am your host, Dr. Gerald Auger, and over the next 45 minutes, me, you, Cherie Slam, Marcus Kyler of the Yeet Crew, Jesse Johnson of the Mod Crew, Kenyan Izo Space Tacos, Kuda Chimera, Robert Cooper here in the greater Phoenix area, folks over on LinkedIn like Logan Fuller, newcomers and old timers, people coming back who've been out for a minute, like Joel B. Good friends like Alana Boyajian, Carol Carroll, Will Lopez, Justin Rohrer, JP, DP, KP, all the P's. Guys, all of us are going to be shredding the top cybersecurity news stories of the day, and I'll be giving my expert opinion and analysis on each of those stories on what it means to you as a practitioner. So how can you use it? How can you use it to drive cyber risk reduction for your business stakeholders? Or if you're looking to break into the industry, believe me, you're going to be asked in any single job interview for a cyber job, how do you stay current on the industry? If you want to absolutely make it to round three of the interview, if you absolutely want to just get a mic like this and then drop it after every interview, this right here is an amazing answer to that question. The Daily Cyber Threat Brief Podcast. I'm not even biased. I'm like objectively saying it's dope. You're going to get all the top stories, the terminology, the concepts, the meta of the industry, and the networking is amazing. I've already introduced you to several people in the community. B-Rad, Not Rich, Johnny Five out of Thailand, Incognito, Laura Flores, Shuttle Crab, Matthew Nechi in the Phoenix area. Matthew, I saw your DM, by the way. It's been bananas. Guys, the networking is exceptional. So say what's up in chat. It's great to have you guys. Can't wait. We've got a great show, chock full of stories. As a quick reminder for those who do not know, I do not research or prep for any of these stories, so you are in for an absolute delightful treat as I just giddy up and get all over these things. I've got a lot of experience in the industry. I'm very passionate about cybersecurity, so I've always got something to kind of rip away, distill out, and give to you to deliver value to you, frankly. So before we get into the news, before I slug this meh cup of coffee, let me say shout out and thanks to the stream sponsors, those businesses that enable me to bring the podcast to you, whether I'm coming to you from the low country or I'm coming to you from not Sarasota, Arizona. Starting with my good friend and crew, Barricade Cyber Solutions. Barricade Cyber Solutions is dedicated to helping businesses from cyber attacks and recover from the damage done. Cyber attacks. They can cause massive issues. For businesses and dedicated, hardworking business owners, send them into absolute turmoil. Trust me, guys, if you've ever been in a like compromised situation, cyber attack, if it's not your first rodeo, if you're not used to being victimized, it is like a 1,000-yard stare. Like you're in World War One, and your lieutenant just told you to get up out of the trench and go across the field. You're like, oh. So what you need is somebody who's experienced that, someone who's battle hardened. People like Barricade Cyber Solutions who can come in and mitigate the threat, mitigate the damage done, and absolutely yeet out those threat actors from the environment. Check them out at barricadecyber.com. Links in the description below. Also want to say shout out and love to Panoptcy Security. Panoptcy, guys, you know it, I know it. Get a partner who understands your cyber program and more importantly, your business goals. What does that mean? It means cyber is a business enabler, right? When you reach a level of cybersecurity skill competency where you can realize that we're here to enable the business, allow them to do the things they want. Like, listen, CIO, Chief Innovation Officer, whatever the heck that title is, I get that you want to do big things, break things and move fast, but what you need to do is do it in a secure way. So allow me to help you do that. But if you are strapped for resources, strapped for time, strapped for money, whatever it is, and you need a little bit of help, Panoptcy Security, that's how you can enable these things to move forward and not be an impediment to the business while still straight up crushing it. All right. Also want to say shout out to Antisyphon Training, but more about them at the mid-roll as usual. If you are currently taking John Strand's Getting Into Cyber with Black Hills and MITRE ATT&CK, please let us know in chat. I'd love to know how that course is going. And make sure that you guys are all getting value from that course since I have been telling you about it. I have no doubt that the course is awesome, but I just wanted to get some real-time feedback from students in the course. Whew. All right, guys. Every episode of the Daily Cyber Threat Briefing is worth half a CPE, so don't be shy. Say what's up in chat. Hashtag TeamSC if you're a Team Simply Cyber community member. Hashtag TeamSC in chat. It's super easy. Just say it. Grab a screenshot. File it away in a folder. Some people in the community, Laura, hold on. Some people have actually gone as far as automating it. So like when you put it in the folder, it automatically timestamps it and does a date and everything like that. So there's ways that you can absolutely kick it. DJ Manny didn't catch the podcast yesterday. DJ Manny, it's okay because he took and passed the CISSP. Come on, Manny. Where you at? Where's my heart? Yes, sir. Nice job, Manny. Crushing it. Look at this guy. Just 5 years in the industry experience, crushing professional, sir. It's no big deal. No big deal. DJ Manny, our newestly minted CISSP cert holder. Congratulations, Manny. Hey, Manny, speaking of your CISSP, get your CPEs here. Get them started now, Manny. Take a picture of you saying you passed the CISSP as the evidence for your first half a CPE for your CISSP requirement. Wonderful. Super happy for you. All right, guys, it's Tidbits Tuesday. No sound effects. Hold on. We got no sound effects? You guys can't hear these things? Come on now. Is Eric Taylor deaf? Are you guys, what are we doing? All right, so Bram SL1's going to take the baton. You guys are good. Look at you guys jumping on it. Do we have sound effects? Can I get some confirmation here? I just got to know if we have sound effects or else I'm going to have to do manual sound effects. Where are we at? We're on a 20-second delay, so I'll just take a slug of this call. Okay, so it was just lower. All right, guys, do me a favor. Wherever you are, whether you're a newly minted CISSP like our friend DJ Manny, or you're studying for the CISSP, or you're getting pumped for Slay Security Plus on Thursday because you're studying for your Security Plus, or you're James Casebolt with a super chat, James.
Did we just become best friends?
Yep.
Thanks for the super chat. Thanks for the super chat, James Casebolt. Awesome, man. Sincerely appreciate that. No matter what you are, do me a favor. Sit back, relax, grab your cup of coffee, whether it's a French press, French roast, delicious cup of coffee that you can only get at your house and you're daydreaming about it, or you're drinking a Starbucks Via Colombian edition, which is like, I couldn't even get an Italian roast. Like, I hate to be such a snob when it comes to the coffee, but like, you know what? The reason that I have go juice, the reason that I'm all amped up in the morning is because I'm very deliberate about my coffee. So whatever it is you got, grab it, sit back, relax, and let's let the cool sounds of the hot news wash over us in an awesome wave. I will see you at the mid-roll.
Security headlines.
These are your cybersecurity headlines for Tuesday, March 19th, 2024. I'm Lauren Verno. United Health fronts over $2 billion in recovery efforts. This is one of those ransomware attacks that we'll likely be talking about for years to come. On Monday, United Health Group, the parent company of Change Healthcare, announced they've advanced payments of over $2 billion to assist healthcare providers affected by that major ransomware attack in late February. The company also stated they've begun releasing medical claim software, which will become available to thousands of customers over the next several days. However, they are still working to restore some services that continue to be offline.
Wow. Okay. I am actually at a so dude, I'm telling you really quickly, I'm at a medical conference. I'm speaking in like, I don't know, 4 hours at a medical conference. And I used to be super, super prepped for everything, like a month in advance, have everything dialed in, practiced everything. And now, like, everything's dialed in. Don't get me wrong, I'm not like a complete yard sale over here. But like, because our industry moves so quickly, I knew without a doubt that there would be something the day of the conference. And wouldn't you know it, my very first story, UnitedHealth advances $2 billion in payments. Guess who just updated their intro slide for the big splash when I start my talk later today? Two thumbs and all smiles. Maybe one thumb and a microphone. This guy. All right, so guys, Change Healthcare absolutely got hosed. Receta ransomware took them down, and the impact was catastrophic, frankly. Like we in the industry, when we have GRC, when we have GRC, like risk ratings and stuff like that, and we're doing a risk assessment, like you very, very seldomly throw the catastrophic impact around. Like it's there, but you better be dang sure that what you're saying is a fact, right? Like if you say, hey, if we don't do this, it will have catastrophic consequences, that word will perk people's ears up and they will turn to you and they will say, explain what, how, explain that. And you have to be able to definitively and objectively bring that person to the same conclusion as you. Long story short, you don't throw the catastrophic term around. This Receta impact was catastrophic, and it was a multi-layered kind of supply chain impact. So I don't even know if you were doing a risk assessment at a healthcare organization, if you would have even identified this as a risk. Because Change Healthcare has all these subsidiaries that provide all sorts of services, and healthcare companies and providers depend on these services as just normal operating, when it doesn't exist anymore, there's a chain of reaction of collapse. This is the example where people were unable to get their prescriptions filled. And the main impact that I've seen right now, and I've seen it on LinkedIn, I don't know if you guys have seen this, but there's like basically hospital companies cannot bill for services, which means they can't get the insurance companies, because they bill to the insurance company, they can't get the insurance companies to process the claims and pay them, which means they can't pay payroll. There are numerous healthcare organizations in the United States right now that their staff haven't been paid in 3 weeks. I saw an article on LinkedIn of a practice, a doctor who owns her own practice, her and a couple other doctors, with a picture of her home. Now her home was gorgeous, right? Like huge, big ass McMansion type thing. Sorry, big thing. And she's like, you know, this is where I raised my kids. My kids took my first step here. We lived here for 20 years. I'm gonna have to put my house on sale to pay payroll. This is where we're at right now. Okay, so like there are real life consequences. It's not just like, oop, I guess I can't log into work today. I'm just gonna go down to Folly Beach and grab some waves. No. There are significant impacts to individuals, to families, etc. So this story is huge, with UnitedHealthcare basically not allowing the healthcare system to fail and fronting $2 billion in payments. Now, before you get out the the roses and start throwing them at UnitedHealthcare's feet, UnitedHealthcare is the insurance company. They're going to be paying the claims anyways, right? So all they're doing is in good faith fronting the process claims that will be coming out. So I do appreciate, instead of them being so cold and so like Scrooge, not Scrooge McDuck, but like Scrooge from Christmas Carol, where like you got to have everything lined up before they issue the payment. So they issue the payment. So this is basically a relief package, in good faith that all the claims, there'll be a little bit of fraud here. No doubt, there'll be some fraud, but for the most part, I assume that this will be stabilized. And I just hope that the $2 billion is enough. I know this sounds absurd, but I hope the $2 billion is enough to get to be the bridge to get these healthcare companies forward. Right now, dude, I don't think you guys understand. There's like a massive migration of people out of healthcare. In fact, if you're trying to break into, I love this I might even put this question in chat. If you are working in cyber or you're looking to pivot into cyber and you came from healthcare, please let us know in chat. I'm actually kind of curious. Like, if you're not paying attention, there is like a freaking migraine of people retiring or leaving because of burnout. COVID destroyed nurses. And then people don't want to get in. Like, most of the people at the conference I'm at are insurance people. Like, healthcare providers getting sued all over the place. Okay, thanks. Next story.
Spyware agreement gains more international support. Six new countries, Finland, Germany, Ireland, Japan, Poland, and South Korea, have joined an alliance of 11 others in a U.S.-led agreement to combat the misuse of commercial spyware. This pact commits these countries to establishing robust guardrails and procedures around spyware usage and to enhancing global awareness of its dangers. Quick Spyware 101, spyware is a malicious software designed to infiltrate mobile phones to eavesdrop and collect data, which poses a significant national security and counterintelligence threat. CNN reports the Biden administration continues to uncover cases targeting American government personnel. In response, the White House has ramped up efforts against this threat, implementing new visa restrictions and sanctions against entities involved in the spyware industry.
All right, so this is such a like Game of Thrones move. Okay, so really quick, I mean, this is cyber, but it feels more like cyber adjacent. Most people are going to agree that spyware like Pegasus, NSO Group's Pegasus, is bad, right? Or it gets weaponized, right? So the ideal thing is that law enforcement uses it to put it in a criminal kingpin's phone and then uncover their like narcotics industry. And then we save a bunch of children from taking opioids and dying, right? Or you get it into some type of like, you know, creepy, disturbed person who's, you know, holding people captive, and then you find where they are using GPS and boom, you got them, right? So these are like the righteous use cases that spy companies will make for you. Congratulations, Becky Gaylord, on passing your CYSA yesterday, like that. But spyware gets weaponized by authoritative regimes for spying on like people who are dissent, right? So like, say I'm in power, right? Like, oh, I'm the king of Westeros, right? And you know, so even if I'm like a horrible king, you can't get me out because I'm in power. So I have control of like the military, of policy, of law. I can make people disappear, right? So countries that are opposed to that, Western kind of belief countries, countries that are into democracy, they don't like that, right? Because it's getting abused. So what they're doing here is they're leading essentially a policy around banning and sanctioning and punishing people that are using spyware, especially for authoritative regimes. Now, this is why this is a Game of Thrones move. United States, obviously first world power, can be like spyware is bad, anyone who uses it. But like, okay, so the rest of the world will just use it like around the United States, no big deal, okay? By the United States reaching out and getting other countries internationally involved, the noose starts to tighten. So you could see here, Japan and South Korea, now we've got Pacific Rim, Asia involvement. So like, you know, like boo China and Russia, okay? Then we've got Ireland, Germany, Finland. So now we've got Europe online, kind of like bookending Russia and China, which China's really like the long pole in the tent as far as like using authoritative powers for abuse. But like there's been tons of Middle Eastern countries that have done it. There's been, and like, let's not mistake that I'm trying to be like xenophobic about certain regions. In Spain, okay, Spain, the guy who's president or prime minister, whatever they do over there in Spain, he was using it on an opponent who was running against him from the, from the region, what was the name in Step Brothers? The Catalina wine mixer? Yeah, like the Catalina region had a candidate that was quite popular and they found Pegasus on his phone. So it's not just like the big bad countries, right? But the final thing I'll point out is it's basically democracy-influenced Western philosophy countries aligning with each other. You're not going to, you're basically not going to see a BRICS country here, like Brazil, Russia, India, South Africa, China, and the other BRICS countries that are coming online, like UAE, Saudi, Iraq, et cetera. So my point is there very much seems to be like a sharks versus jets thing going on here with NATO or Western democracy and the BRICS people. So to me, that's what this is. Like, yes, no one, they don't want spyware, et cetera, but in order to influence the policy and set the national strategy and basically influence with national power, you need to like team up like a faction and have more people in there. So I don't know, like we won't say it on stream because that would be bad for Kennedy, but you know, here we go. It's just you know, the Catalina wine mixer. I don't have the Nelson laughing. So, ha ha ha. Okay, let's keep going.
FTC probes Reddit's AI data licensing ahead of IPO. The Federal Trade Commission is investigating whether Reddit should be allowed to license its user-generated content to artificial intelligence companies. Now, as you can imagine, many Reddit users took to the social media platform to express their concerns about their insights being sold to the highest bidder. This inquiry was revealed in a recent securities filing as Reddit prepares for its IPO. The investigation focuses on whether Reddit's actions constitute unfair or deceptive practices under consumer protection laws. Reddit, which has struck a deal with Google worth $60 million a year to share data for AI training, said in the filing that they were, quote, not surprised that the FTC has expressed interest in this area, end quote, but maintains they do not believe they're doing anything wrong.
All right, so polarizing topic. I think it's because it is Reddit, where, you know, what is Reddit's thing, like the internet's front page or something like that? There's a lot of personal opinions, you know, a lot of, you know, I feel like Reddit, you know, if you're on the Simply Cyber Discord server, exclamation point, thank you, Aji Tinsdale, Catalan, not Catalina region. If you are on the Simply Cyber Discord server, exclamation point, Discord in chat, if you want to join, you know, like Reddit is kind of like a Reddit forum is like the OG Discord server. You know, that's kind of how I think of it. So people feel a certain sense of ownership, a certain sense of pride, a certain sense of self with these Reddit forums, especially if you're an active poster on it. It's very similar to the Simply Cyber community, right? You see the same people in there. You share updates. You know, you get to know people. You ask them personal questions like, how's, you know, oh, you were sick. Are you feeling better? Like these things. So when Reddit decides that they're going to basically go public and start monetizing their content, there feels a certain level of violation. Now, this isn't really a cybersecurity story, so I really don't want to spend all that much time on it. Yeah, and I agree. Justin Gold just brought this up. If you're in Aaron Swartz, the guy who like invented Reddit, kind of a tragic story. There's a documentary on him. It's either on Netflix or it's on YouTube that really explains and outlines what's going on. But like Reddit was kind of supposed to be like for the people, by the people, accessible to the people. And the idea that it's going to be monetized is part of the issue. What I would say, I mean, this is just my opinion. Okay. Like that's what I'm doing up here. No one pays for Reddit, right? Like Reddit has infrastructure costs. Yes, there's some ads and stuff, but they're sitting on a gold mine of value. Data, especially human generated data, is gold. I mean, it's literally, it's like sitting on, imagine if you will, okay, for just a minute. Okay, imagine if you will, you buy a big piece of property, all right? And you're like, you know what? This property's beautiful. I shouldn't just hoard it myself. I'm going to put a park here. I'm going to put a playground over here. I'm going to put some picnic benches over here, maybe a little soccer goal over here. And I'm going to tell everybody in the community, they're free to use my park. Come use my park. Have fun. And people come have picnics there. They raise their kids there. memories are made, okay? And then all of a sudden, someone does like a site survey and discovers there's a diamond mine underneath the park. What, like, how could you hold that guy account? How could you hold him accountable for wanting to mine the diamonds? Now, having said that, this isn't one individual with righteous virtues. This is a faceless business who's trying to squeeze every dollar out of every single opportunity. But you, if you wanted to be a glass half full kind of guy or lady, you might say, hey, maybe all this money that's getting infused into Reddit is going to partially go back into the Reddit community, provide more features, provide more options and capabilities. Probably not. It's probably just cash grabs so someone can buy a bigger boat. But, you know, I'm trying to play a little bit as devil's advocate, especially, yeah, exactly. So BSEC, I love it. Thank you. BSEC is saying in mod chat, Reddit is public. Dumping it into LLM would make it more accessible. This is 100% true. Think about it for a second. I mean, in all honesty, I would be stunned if ChatGPT hadn't already ingested Reddit, right? I mean, ChatGPT is basically built off of like 40% of the internet. I'd be stunned if Reddit wasn't in there already. But my point is, when you stick this content in, it becomes very easy to access and glean insights and stuff like that. So, yeah, Aaron Swartz is a really sad story. So, anyways, you know, it's not a cyber story, but it is a culture story, right? And it's one that so DeJoko says Reddit's IPO launches in 2 days, thus the investigation. This, I mean, I guess, does this hold up the IPO, by the way? I wonder if this holds up the IPO, or if, like, it'll just be, like, ongoing. So, we'll see. If it does hold it up, it makes me think it's, like, a straight cash homie kind of thing, where it's like, hey, sure would be bad if we did an investigation and screwed up your IPO. You know what I mean? Like a shakedown kind of thing. Keith Sloan, you're funny. Come on.
Homeland Security lays out plan to incorporate AI. The Department of Homeland Security is embracing AI with open arms. On Monday, the agency released a plan highlighting three pilot projects. Homeland Security investigations will test AI for investigating processes to detect fentanyl and combating child sexual exploitation. Mm-hmm. The Federal Emergency Management Agency, or FEMA, will deploy AI for hazard mitigation, and the United States Citizenship and Immigration Services will use AI for immigration officer training. The pilot program is expected to cost $5 million and, according to the New York Times, will utilize AI models like OpenAI's ChatGPT and partner with Meta, Microsoft, Google, and Amazon.
Okay. So, let's go. So, there's a roadmap, okay? Here's the deal. This isn't coming as a surprise to anyone, okay? Also not two things. One, not another not cyber story. Two, Lauren Verno, I love her reading today. Like, good pauses in there. Dude, everyone's using AI. Like, I've said it a million times. If you're not using AI, you're going to get left behind. I don't mean that as a threat. That's not a dig. That's not judging. It's just a fact. If you're not using AI, you will be left behind. It's going to become, like, a basic, you know, civil skill that everyone's going to have to use, okay? It's no surprise that DHS is rolling out ways to use AI. Remember, CISA is a agency under the Department of Homeland Security. DHS has, like, I want to say, like, eight different agencies under it. CISA is one. ICE is another. There's a couple. I think Coast Guard is under DHS as well, not DOD. So don't fall for that trick. And they're using it in all sorts of ways. Detecting fentanyl, tracking down child predators, like all the like righteous use cases that this is my thing. Like, getting drugs off the street and getting creeps off the street, those are the two go-to righteous use cases. And getting like mass shooter type people off the street, those are the go-to righteous use cases that any new technology that law enforcement adopts is like, that's what they're doing. Cause no one is going to say like, oh no. Like that's not a good use case. Like we need more fentanyl on the street. Like no one's going to argue that. So, but at the same time, I'm not saying that there's some like nefarious alternative agenda going on that they're hiding in the noise on this one. So I appreciate it. I don't know how AI training border patrol is going to result in better outcomes down on the border, but we'll see how it goes. I do think that there's an opioid crisis in the United States, especially I can vouch for Massachusetts specifically, but DHS announced it would hire 50 AI experts for the AI Corps. Okay, so apparently, there you go. Go to a job fair if you want to get hired as an AI expert. I don't know if this is like people who like generate AI or if this is people who use AI, like prompt engineers. Hold on. OPM announced flexible hiring authorities for AI-related positions. This is a development. OPM Direct Hire Authority accepted service appointments to support Biden's AI order. So what I'm getting from this, of course, I'm going down the rabbit hole now, y'all, is that it looks like they're going to build out like an AI either capability or like a department of AI. I could see that coming, or like some AI czar. Like basically, look what they did with cybersecurity. I don't know if you've got gray hair, you may remember this, but for like a long time, like cyber was just like a capability within like the NSA and like some military branches. Then there was like a cyber command, right, which was like kind of consolidated. Then there was like executive branch cyber czar, and then they got rid of that, and now there's like Space Force and stuff with like cyber's got its own, you know, capability, its own soldiers, its own everything. So AI may take this trajectory as well, where they, you know, it starts becoming like a deliberate role within the stuff, and then it turns into its own like agency in the United States. I don't know where the heck it would fall under, because it's not really a military capability, although it's got military implications. But if Nick Barker wants to become a AI computer engineer or computer scientist, if cyber is not your bag and you're looking to get into AI, apparently the US government is hiring. And this all aligns to the executive memo that Biden rolled out around the safe and deliberate use of AI going forward for the United States. So, anyways, a lot of interesting things. I don't catch me on jawjack. I have so many jawjacking things, like the anonymous Sudan thing, some jawjacking things around AI that I learned here at this conference around the use of AI in medical. I'll just give you a little quick teaser. Specific case around a doctor who was a cardiologist who was reading images from cardiograms, but there was AI involved, and the AI would do diagnosis. So the doctor was just like rubber stamping, because he's like, well, I'm not going to argue with AI. Like, so rubber stamp, rubber stamp, rubber stamp. So basically AI was the was the physician. And, you know, obviously the fact that I know about it would indicate that downstream it didn't work out very well for the people involved.
And now from our sponsor, Vanta. From dozens of spreadsheets and screenshots to fragmented tools and manual security reviews, managing the requirements for modern compliance and security programs is increasingly challenging. Vanta is a leading trust management platform that helps you centralize your efforts to establish trust and enable growth across your organization. Over 6,000 companies partner with Vanta to automate compliance, strengthen security posture, streamline security reviews, and reduce third-party risk. To learn more, go to vanta.com/CISO and watch their 3-minute product demo. That's vanta.com/CISO.
All right. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the mid-roll. We got a little Simply Cyber Breakfast Club. Hopefully, you're having a good stream. What's up, Ben? Good to see you. Thanks for the super chat, Ben. Heck yeah, we did. Thanks, Ben, with the super chat. Loving it, loving it, loving it. Let me give a little heart to Ben. Oh, chat moves so quick, you guys. Holla, holla, holla. I hope you guys are having a great stream. I am in Scottsdale, Arizona, not Sarasota. I'm in Scottsdale here for a conference. And appreciate all of you, understanding that the mobile studio is 80% of the production studio. So I got the proof of life light on my face here. I should hold up like a newspaper with today's date on it. 456 beautiful people in chat right now. Let's go. Love it, love it, love it. Hey, guys, so if you're getting value from the stream, do me a solid. Hit that like button on YouTube simply because it helps people like Tony Patterson, Medine, John P. It helps people who didn't know about us yesterday find out about us tomorrow. You know what I mean? So I don't care about the vanity metrics. I don't go back and look how many likes I got. I don't care about that. It's basically, if you hit the like button enough, YouTube's like, oh, look, cyber people like this content. Let me go show more cyber people. That's how the YouTube algorithm works. So pay it forward and grab that like button and shake it. All right, guys, shout out to the stream sponsors, Barricade Cyber, Panoptcy, and Antisyphon Training. Guys, many of you are in the Antisyphon getting started with this class right here, literally this class, getting started in security of Black Hills and MITRE ATT&CK. If you didn't know, Antisyphon Training is disrupting the traditional cybersecurity training industry by providing high-quality, cutting-edge education to everyone, regardless of financial position. That means that students with no worry of how am I going to pay for this, are able to learn skills, practice what is taught, learn from freaking boss teachers with tons of experience, like John Strand. John Strand, amazing person, amazing practitioner, inspiring individual. So take advantage of it. Go to antisyphontraining.com. At a minimum, bookmark it. Above minimum, below maximum. Look through their catalog of courses and see if there's one that lines up for you. Don't let cost get in your way of progress, okay? I'll say it a million times. Like, I have courses for sale on my school. I would want you to do the free stuff first. Do the free stuff first. We live in the freaking golden age of cyber education being accessible to everybody. Do it. If it's not about the money, then it comes down to initiative and taking the time and making it a priority. All right. Thanks, Antisyphon Training. Love you guys. All right, guys. Every single day of the week has a Simply Cyber Community Challenge. Whoops. Joel Belton had the Simply Cyber Community Challenge baton, and he passed it to, I believe, Bram L1. If someone in chat can confirm or mods, who got the baton? I think the baton's already been passed. But here's the deal. Go on LinkedIn if you would like to blow up your LinkedIn feed, right? Which means great professional contacts and your actual feed itself is cyber-focused. Go on LinkedIn and search for this hashtag, Simply Cyber Community Challenge, right? Search for this hashtag and connect with the people posting, comment on their posts, connect with the people in the comments. 5 minutes a day, active work. The rest of the day, the 23 hours and 55 minutes, other people who are doing the same challenge will connect with you. I promise you, multiple people in chat can attest to this. It will blow up your professional network on LinkedIn. So don't sleep on this. This is just another service that the Simply Cyber community provides to its stakeholders or community, because we know how important it is to network. Every single day of the week has a special segment, and Tuesdays is Tidbit Tuesday, where I share a little bit about myself and see if we resonate, see if we jive. Thanks, Bram, SL1, for picking that up. I don't really have a Tidbit Tuesday today. I did run yesterday, as I told you, around Scottsdale, 6 miles. Never been to Arizona before. Good times. And I definitely enjoyed my run and can see why people move here. Super nice. Also, fun fact, going out to lunch with Robert Cooper from the Simply Cyber community today, some rooftop bar. I think it's tacos and good beers. Yes, sir. So definitely looking forward to all that. And bonus, if you live in the Low Country or South Carolina region, go check out the Simply Cyber Low Country Locals channel, the meetup channel on the Simply Cyber Discord server. Casually, Joseph and I are organizing a meetup on April 3rd, and we're trying to get a headcount. So that's your Tidbits Tuesday. Let's get back to the news.
Japanese tech giant confirms data breach. Fujitsu, the world's sixth largest IT services provider, confirmed that they discovered malware on several of their computer systems and that personal data and customer information may have been impacted. Now, the release did not offer much information, including the type of malware used or the specific personal information that may have been stolen. The company did say they reported the incident to Japan's Data Protection Authority, quote, in anticipation, end quote, that personal data was taken.
Yeah, okay. What's up, Arian Sagetti, by the way, in chat? Guys, Arian and I have known each other for years. I'm a big fan of Arian Sagetti, smart guy. Love me some Arian Sagetti. If you see him, high five him. Hopefully, Arian, we can catch up at Black Hat Vegas. Okay, so Fujitsu, everybody knows Fujitsu. A million years ago, I had a Fujitsu laptop. They're like one of those sleepy companies that, like, they're kind of everywhere, but you don't really notice them because they're not, you know, the biggest player. But they're, you know, technology giant out of Japan. They got hit with a cyber attack. When I see a question like this, or excuse me, when I see a story like this, the first question that you could, you should ask yourself, or I ask myself, okay, data breach. Like, the question is, define data. Is it your partner's Fujitsu? Is it your internal financial documents? Is it your employee data? Is it your customer data? Is it a specific division of Fujitsu? Like their, you know, windmill division or whatever? You know what I mean? Like, when you just say, like, blanket, you know, generic data breach, it doesn't really tell you anything, because here's the thing. If it's like, you know, semiconductor technology or whatever, well, maybe the share prices are going to go down and I care about that. If it's employee data, well, maybe, you know, I worked there and I care. You know what I mean? So, like, you need more intel on what this is. Okay, so stolen personal data of customers and personal data and customer information. So personal data of who, though? Like, customers or the employees? Sounds like it was an information stealer, not a ransomware attack, because they're not down. They didn't specify what kind of malware was used, but you can kind of read between the lines. By the way, if you use a technology like Flare.io, which I'm a huge fan of, Flare.io, you might be able to glean what kind of information was actually compromised. To me, it does sound like an info stealer, though, simply because, you know, For me personally, the kind of crude analysis is, are they still up or are they down? If they're down, it's highly likely it's ransomware, unless their internet-facing assets are down, which would then be a distributed denial-of-service attack. If they're not down but there's been a data breach, then chances are it's an info stealer. Or like, some threat actors are not even encrypting anymore and just doing data exfil. Clop ransomware, famously. But Clop ransomware is still trying to dig out of their MOVEit breach. So you probably won't see them until, like, late 2024, early 2025, when they come up for air. Unless they cash out their chips and go buy a big boat. This story has very little meat to it. This story is, like, really shiny, and then you look at it from, like, even one degree from the side, and it's paper thin. Fujitsu reported it to the country's data protection authority, which I'm assuming there's some type of, like, legal requirement for them to report. You gotta, companies will do exactly what they're required to do and nothing more. Very rarely do they come out and righteously do above and beyond. You're not going to see any, like, lawyer or CEOs like, you know what we should do? We should really go into detail on why we were compromised. Like,
83,000 exposed in mortgage lender breach. Nation Direct Mortgage, a Nevada-based company, reports that the data of more than 83,000 customers was leaked in a late 2023 attack. Now, in a recent filing, the company said social security numbers and other sensitive information was exposed after an unauthorized third party was able to obtain access to the systems. The lender, which operates out of 35 states, says they are offering victims 2 years of identity protection services.
Mm-hmm. Someone told me at dinner last night, they're sitting across from me, they're like, I was like scammed or something, or like if you don't know, you don't know, but like she fell for a fish, but it was like one of those Best Buy scam fishes. So like nothing came of it, but she went and got a year of identity theft protection because she was concerned. She said, is that enough? And I said, I have like six identity theft protections running concurrently. I said, you probably have identity theft protection that you just don't even know about because your data has been compromised a million times. This, like, the identity theft protection and, like, your data is, like, your privacy of your data is, like, a priority to us is, like, such a punchline in the meta of our society right now. All right, so mortgage lender gets breached. There was a big news story a couple weeks ago, or like a couple months ago. If you guys don't remember, like financial mortgage industry, like there was like multiple victims like in a row, like boom, boom, boom. So now this is just coming out. It looks like they've done their investigation, their due diligence of, you know, what the impact was, how bad was the breach, et cetera. And now they're coming out and say 83,000 customers affected. Here's your identity theft protection. You'll notice that, again, like, thank God for California and Maine, the two states in the United States that are pushing privacy regulations to the forefront. Like, a lot of times we find out, we, like, General Joe, John and Jane Q Public, find out about things because companies have to disclose to Maine and California. And when they do, like, people are like, wait a minute, what about South Carolina? And then, like, you know, it comes out like, oh geez, like this is a hot mess express. So I mean, that's a side story, that's a privacy thing. If you want, you know, I can't say which is better, California or Maine. California has always been kind of the front runner of privacy. And if you're looking for a national privacy regulation, that's not going to happen, so don't expect that anytime soon for multiple reasons. But Mr. Cooper was another one of those data breaches. Here's the deal, guys. With the data that was dropped in this particular leak, it's not so much about protecting your businesses as much as it's protecting, like, your Aunt Donna, your cousin Brian, your son, your daughter, like, anybody that has a mortgage. When you, if you don't know, like when you go to apply for a mortgage, unless you're like a baller, whoops, hold on, wrong one. Straight cash, homie. Unless you're Randy Moss and you're just dropping straight, like you bring a duffel bag of cash to the closing, chances are you're taking out a mortgage, okay? Like most people take out a mortgage. Well, when you take a mortgage out, because it's a huge loan, the mortgage lender wants to know every freaking thing about you. How much debt do you have? How often do you pay your debt? How often have you had your job? Are you reliable? All the reasons, because they're going to make a decision on A, what's your interest rate, right? So how much are you going to pay back? B, are they even going to lend you the money? C, like what's the terms of the agreement, like how long and everything like that. So there's lots and lots and lots of juicy, juicy financial data bits in there. If I'm a threat actor, threatactoracademy.com, what you learn in your second semester at Threat Actor Academy is targeting your victims. Guys, no one, like, let's just be real for a second. Why would you spend, if you have like 1 hour of time to like do an attack, are you just going to randomly pick someone out of the bag and hope that they're a good target? Or are you going to do 10 minutes of like research, sort by value or, you know, like net worth, and go target a high value net worth individual? Like, obviously, I'm not even a criminal and that makes sense to me. It's obvious, right? So that's the real impact of this attack. Yeah, Nations Direct, ooh, got a little egg on your face. Ooh, it's a little embarrassing. But in reality, the real victims of this are the 83,000 people whose sensitive personal financial information and sensitive details like social, driver's license, I'm sure, passport number, all these things, addresses, all those things can lead to identity theft, fraudulent activity, fake IRS tax filings, social engineering attacks, like those are the real victims. And that's the part that blows. And quasi, sorry, Kennedy. That's the part that sucks, guys. Like, even if you give me identity theft protection, like, you know what identity theft protection doesn't cover? If I call, like, a credit card company, pretend to be you, and, like, run something, or I trick someone. Like, it's, I don't know. To me, like, identity theft has, like, a very specific definition, and there's other ways to, like, weaponize it. If I convince you that I work for a bank, because I know all this details, and I'm going to force you to, like, pay me a fee or a tax or your whatever is going to be revoked, and you do it, that's not identity theft. That's me just tricking you into sending me $500 Amazon gift card or something stupid like that. So, anyways, yeah, freeze your credit if you can. That's such a good move. It's a pain in the ass if you have to do something, but, I mean, how often are you, like, getting a car or getting a home loan or something like that where it's not that inconvenient? All right. Also, side note, since it's Tidbits Tuesday, shout out to the threat actor who tried to file my taxes, my personal taxes in 2023, or my 2022 taxes. True story. I went to file my taxes for 22, and the government was like, wait a minute, you already filed. And I was like, no. And then, like, we got it sorted out. But the punchline here is that I owed like 10 grand to the U.S. government. So some threat actor tried to, like, file my taxes, and they're like, sure, no problem. Give us 10 grand. The threat actor was like, you know that meme of, like, the guy who's like that, that was definitely the threat actor. Donkey. See, this is why you got to choose better victims. Like, I'm definitely not a good target.
Time to patch your Fortinet appliances. Despite Fortinet patching a critical security flaw in its Forta OS over a month ago, more than 133,000 Fortinet appliances remain vulnerable, with the highest numbers of exposures in Asia. This vulnerability, rated a 9.6 out of 10 for severity, allows for remote code execution and has already been actively exploited, as confirmed by Fortinet and CISA. The availability of proof of concepts online increases the risk of attacks on these vulnerable systems. Now, like the Bernie Sanders meme, security experts are once again asking for this vulnerability to get patched.
Oh my gosh, look at Lauren Verno. I really, we got to get Lauren Verno on the channel. I really like Lauren Verno's delivery. So funny. Okay, so guys, like, if this is your first episode, hashtag first timer in chat, you may not have known. If you're a long timer, then you know that Fortinet is on fire. Where's my dumpster fire emote? There we go. All right. There you go. So here's the deal. If you're running Fortinet, you got to patch it. Oh, you got to patch it. Manual sound effect for Nick Barker there. You got to patch it, y'all. Like, straight up, period, end of story. A month old critical bug. What the f*** are you doing? What are you doing? Listen, I get it. Equifax got hit a few years ago. They had a really, really complicated custom build of Apache Struts that you couldn't take offline. And it got popped, and that's when the Equifax breach happened, okay? But, bruh, if you're running Fortinet with a month-old critical bug, what in the hell are you doing? Sorry, Kennedy, but you know what? This might be where you learn HE double hockey sticks, because this is redonkulous. You can find these devices with Shodan. You can pop these suckers, right? I'm not saying you should. I'm just saying, like, if I can find them, then a threat actor can find them. Guys, if you've ever put a honeypot on the internet, go put a honeypot on the internet. I have a video on the channel. I didn't, like, optimize it for SEO or anything, but there's a video on the channel where I stand up a honeypot. Within, like, 10 minutes, it's getting poked and prodded like it's a... Well, that's not suitable for work. It's getting poked and prodded, I guess. Just put it that way. Within 10 minutes, right? So, like, threat actors and researchers alike, they can scan the internet 0.0.0.0 through 255 on all four octets. That's the range for an IPv4 address. So it's not complicated to find those things. So TLDR, if you're running Fortinet, please fix it. Also, Eric Taylor will be joining us for jawjacking. He has a special penchant for Fortinet and a certain visceral response for Fortinet. So stay tuned for that. Come on, Lauren.
Pensacola joins a growing list of city governments attacked. It's spring break season for many beaches across Florida, and while it's never an ideal time to be a victim of a cyber attack, some would agree this is less than ideal. Pensacola's city government is experiencing widespread phone outages across various departments, although emergency services remain operational. Details about whether the attack involved ransomware or if a ransom demand was made have not been disclosed. I bring this up because the city is no stranger to cyber attacks. In 2019, it spent $300,000 to recover from an incident after the Maze ransomware gang stole 2 gigabytes of data. The recent incident in Pensacola comes just days after an attack left outages in Birmingham, Alabama, as we first reported on Monday.
All right. So Pensacola getting hit, municipality getting hit. Really quickly, I saw Glum Hippo. I saw Glum Hippo ask who's Kennedy. People have asked in the past. Basically, Kennedy was the first known child who was a member of the Simply Cyber community. So a lot of people will watch the show. I know Dan Reardon does sometimes with Pearl. Other people, Jesse Johnson, Base Case. So like there are kids in our audience, which is part of the reason, like I don't typically swear anyways, but like I try to keep this very family friendly. And anytime that I do go off the rails and cuss, I apologize to Kennedy because she's basically the avatar for all children in the audience. So that's the story behind that. Okay, guys. If you work for a municipality, you have an unbelievable corpus of case study demonstrating that you are going to get hit with a cyber attack. Period. End of story. Birmingham hit. Alabama hit. So you got your state, you got your local, Spartanburg, South Carolina, Baltimore, if you want to go back to 2017, Atlanta twice, hot Atlanta, so hot. It was so nice, they popped it twice. We got the LA County School District, Minneapolis School District, Dallas, Texas recently. Guys, pick your poison. Your municipalities are underfunded. They don't typically have dedicated InfoSec resources. They're certainly not a for-profit business, so they're looking to raise just enough money to drive city projects and stuff like that. So what ends up happening is they become a soft target. As usual, 911 and emergency services are still online. Clearly, 911 services are typically separated from primary IT operations for a business. It's spring break down there. You know, I don't know. Like, maybe with emergency services, I mean, it's a bunch of 18 to 22-year-olds doing shots. Like, I don't know. Like, I'm not too worried about it. I mean, it sucks, right? You don't want to be hit with a ransomware attack at all. They did say, as you remember, the Maze ransomware gang attacked them in 2019. I would almost hope that because of that incident, they learned from it, got some budget, hired some more staff, did some practice on recovering from a ransomware attack. So hopefully that's the case. We'll see what happens. But you, again, like I said earlier, when you see like, knocks out, that typically means ransomware, okay? Like systems down, offline. That's typically ransomware in 2024. So we'll see. It's almost become like meh. Like it almost doesn't even rise to the level of needing to be on the Chiron when city gets hit with ransomware attack. All right. How are we doing on time? Ooh, right on time. Someone call Nick Barker.
How can security teams do their jobs?
All right, y'all. Hey, I got a couple things to share with you. One, I'm just so busy this week. I haven't told anyone. This Friday, I'm going to be the guest on CISO series. You know how they do like a Friday roundup live stream type thing? I'll be the guest this week. So if you guys want to come raid CISO series stream, we can giddy up on that. Let me see. So, all right, guys, if you were here just for the news, holla, holla, holla. We did it. I hope you enjoyed the crap out of the stream. We kind of didn't set a new record, but we were at 454, 460 people at one point. So Tuesdays are looking pretty lit here in Simply Cyber. I will be traveling today, so I'm doing my talk at 9:15 local. Then I'm going to eat lunch with Robert Cooper, try a local beer. Hey, now. And then I have the most ridiculous travel itinerary, bringing me back into the low country at midnight, which totally sucks. But don't worry, I'll be back at 8 a.m. tomorrow morning, like it didn't even happen, coming to you live from the studio. Oh, I appreciate it. We got an explanation from, we got an exclamation point Kennedy coming in there. So, hey, you know what? Let me do this. I'm going to pivot over. If you're here just for the news, be good. I'll see you tomorrow. And if you want to do a little jawjacking, let's boogie on that. I'm Jerry from Simply Cyber. Until next time, stay secure. Hold on, I gotta... What's up, everybody? Welcome to jawjacking. I think Eric Taylor may have had a conflict, but that's okay. I don't have to speak for another 3 hours and 15 minutes. The beauty of West Coast living. Where's my Pacific time zone people at? I got you guys all in chat right now. It's great to see you. Hope you enjoyed the show. Got the midnight shirt on, representing the midnight. Love it. Like I said before, if you are going to be in the Eastern South Carolina region on April 3rd, I'm putting together a little locals meetup. Yeah, no problem, mods, no problem. I can chill. Eric Taylor will be joining us, but until then, your boy Jerry Guy is ruling the airwaves up in here, coming at you. Nick Barker, my man, good to see you. Hopefully you guys got your Wild West Hackenfest ticks. I know all sorts of community members are going there. Josh Mason's going to be doing a workshop. He's going to be presenting. Eric Taylor, Casually Joseph are like platinum black sponsors or whatever. Simply Cyber is going to be there representing. Got a booth. Jesse Johnson and SlaySec Plus is going to co-booth with me. We're doing the sponsor stampede. Nice. Brian Mulder, jogging in Paradise Valley is decent. Very cool. I love, if I have the opportunity, guys, I love running in new cities. Like, to me, like, it's a really fun way to experience a city and get to see it. Fun fact, I'm currently not going to RSA, but I'm in the discussions of possibly going. Like, I might get sent by a vendor. For like to basically stand in their booth and shake people's hands. So, all right, it looks like we got our friend Eric Taylor in the hizzy. Let's bring him on. Eric, you're on with Jerry. First time, long time?
First time, long time, west of the Rockies.
I love it. Good to see you. So, Eric, what can we expect from jawjacking today?
Man, I was trying to get some stories together, but then our EDR decided to blow up because somebody thinks it's a great idea to keep clicking the damn Windows Quick Assist application over and over and over again.
So it's I was not working. Dealing with... It should be quicker.
Yeah. And, you know, the EDR is like application blocked, application blocked, application blocked. Why?
That reminds me of a true story. And one of the reasons why I hate the phone call for multi-factor authentication, if you ever get a chance to implement the phone call for multi-factor authentication, you should... put it in a trash can and then throw a bunch of M80s on it, light it, and then walk away. A threat actor got the username and password of a physician and was trying to log in, and it was constantly ringing the physician in the middle of the night. So the
MFA
physician
bomb,
hits decline, decline, decline. And then eventually he hit approve. And guess what happened? The phone stopped ringing and the physician was able to go back to sleep, which is what he ultimately wanted. Of course, the threat actor logged in and started doing all sorts of shenanigans under the physician's account. But it just goes to show you, you got to think through the reality of what these experiences are like. Same with the pop-up, right? If like you're trying to like use your phone and it's like pop, 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 that's distracting. So you got to educate your end users and, you know, have a good multi-factor solutions.
Absolutely. All right.
Let me get out of your way, Eric Taylor. Thanks, as always, for hosting Jawjacking. Community, be good. I'll see you guys tomorrow from the...
welcome, everybody. Good to see everybody. Hope you're doing well. You know, that's a kind of a running joke. So I've always made a joke in the past where, and thanks to Haircut Fish for actually making the meme for it, but Dr. Gerald Auger would be like, you know, not going to talk about this or whatever. I'm like, move out of my way. I'll talk about it. Give me a second. I'll just. So I'm a different level of spicy, ladies and gentlemen. So, but to kick this thing off, those who know, I mean, I know Dr. Gerald Auger's talked about it. It's been on our social medias a little bit, but we are the black sponsor of Wild Wild Hacking Fest, and we are trying to come up with some interesting ideas to make it memorable. So we've already come up with, we were going to do a bunch of ducks, and apparently there's like a river that runs through the hotel. So I was going to do like a mountainous running of the rubber duckies, but we might get in trouble with the hotel. I would like to be allowed to come back. So, as much as I would love to do that, we're not going to. We definitely are coming up with some retro games. Now, I was looking at it last night because me, Casually Joseph, Kimberly Cafix, you know, the team got together and we were coming to trying to figure out some stuff. So we're thinking about some old school Mario Kart, Donkey Kong, maybe Contra, setting up like two or three of the, like if you ever been to GameStop or whatever, you had that like that monitor and you had the controller where you could be able to, you know, play the game that you wanted to. I found a couple of stands like that, so I'm looking at trying to get some of that stood up. But if you've ever wanted to do something cool in there, do me a favor and just go like drop it in here. But if you're watching this after the fact, definitely go to the Discord channel, like the general chat or something like that. And just like Wild Wild Hacking Fest idea, right? And let us know what your thoughts are. Kimberly can fix it. You're spilling all the beans. Not totally yet. I'm not doing all of it yet. Yes, I do. Let me fire up my... Like I said, I was getting prepped for the show. And literally, one of my clients, Carl's, had to show up and be like, let's click on this. Click assist. So, this is one thing I always gripe about. So, you know, here at Barricade, and we recommend everybody doing this. So, if you're not doing this today, after the show, full break, this is what you need to be doing. If you need to be looking for new services that are being installed within the past 24 hours, new applications that are being installed within the past 24 hours, because not all applications are registered. You got to look at your services as well. And look at off-the-land tools. You know, is TeamViewer an allowed application in this environment? Why is that being installed? Is, you know, SplashTop, is Screen Connect, whatever the case is, be looking for those things. And I can tell you right now that the built-in Quick Assist for Windows has not been used by any of our clients that we manage at all. They also use commercially bought products with MFAs most of the time. And, you know, they don't use the built-in thing. So when a user is launching quickassist.exe, that is a massive, massive red flag for me. So we're going to go ahead, because I have not had a chance to still work on my darn thing. We'll do this. We'll do this. We'll fire this up. We'll spin this around. We'll fire up some music. So what hotbed topics, because I'm running out of coffee and I'm about to hit the liquor. So if it's only 9 o'clock this morning, what do y'all want to talk about? What do y'all want to hear from me? Rex coming off the gate. Love it. What are your thoughts on the attack against CISA? Somebody's getting fired. That's my thought. I don't know too much about the specifics of it yet, but there's enough there that somebody's having a somebody's gonna have a very, very bad day real soon. And I actually need to turn this thing down in my ear. I will have some more, and I'm sure we're gonna do a video on it a little bit more, probably later today or tomorrow, once we have a little bit more information, or I've had at least enough time to digest the information. I'm literally in battling 50 different things right now, so trying to keep up on all the latest stuff is a little hard at the moment. Thoughts on the NVIDIA new robots? I have not seen those. I have been seeing the AI for a large language model, or LLM, which I think Reddit was doing it. CrowdStrike just came out, said that they're partnering with NVIDIA for their LLM. Again, large language model for threat hunting and things of that nature. It's going to be interesting to see how they do that. So I'm sure more to come. Yo, Carrie, why do you need some coffee, Eric? Because coffee helps keep people alive. I don't unhealth insure people when I have coffee. Got a super chat from Mono Julian. Hello, everybody. I am open for new opportunities. Mono Julian, I don't like people going, or I hate to send people to other Discords. I don't know if simply, well, let me, before I do that, mods, because I've admitted numerous times that I am not the most efficient person when it comes to Discord. Do we have a hiring page or anything like that in our channel? If not, I might tell this individual to go to another Discord. You know, they're a sponsor, I'll just say that. But let me just type this in mod chat. Discord. Discord has a hiring form. So I just dropped that in a mod chat. I don't want to send away from the community. I'm just kind of scrolling on my left side. Okay, so Jessica, thank you so much. So, yeah, there's So, Mono Julian, if you're not into Discord for Simply Cyber, thank you so much for Justin Gold for recommending that. There is the channel for job applications, open job postings, and main job hunt class. I will say it, you know, but definitely Black Hills has some forms over there for their for their job offering. So I forget what the hashtag is, but if you just ask it in chat, there's like a hashtag you drop and it'll automatically open you up into stuff, so that way you can be able to submit things. It's not like a publicly open type of thing. Hey, Joseph, what's that one site you were telling me to load up for the royalty-free stuff? I just want to hear something a little different without... Let's see. If I was in SE, Eric, I would go get you more coffee. I don't even know how to make jet fuel. To be honest with you, I mean, so you don't know, I'm on the second floor of a building. The coffee is on the first floor of the building. It takes me 4 minutes. I've honestly thought about bringing and putting thank you, Casual. I'll bring that up right now. I thought about bringing up or putting a coffee pot up here, but then I got to figure out, okay, I got to get a refrigerator up here because I like it with creamer. I'm not totally the jet fuel. I was going to make a joke. Thank God I didn't. I'll put it in mod chat, though, just so people can laugh. Some people are going to facepalm over that one. Luke, yes. Yes. So, you know, I don't want to say that. Never mind. But yeah, Irish coffee. Yeah, we'll just say that. Sorry, mod chat. Like I said, I'm definitely a different, different level of spicy this morning. Oh yeah, no, I can't help myself, Kimberly. If it can fix it. I'm gonna bring up this other site real quick. I don't know if I want that one. Thank goodness I'm not doing this on. I might need to sign into Apple real quick. Give me 1 second. Just so I'm not playing YouTube ads. Speaking of 2FA, while I'm doing all this stuff, if you don't have geo-blocking and 2FA on your Apple account, you're on crack, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks, Kimberly. I greatly appreciate it, ma'am. I do see a question pending for me. Just bear with me 1 second. All right, I'm going to stop this. This looks interesting. No. Yeah. All right, so Marcus, why do companies allow? I need to do something else. My apologies. Bear with me 1 second. All right, Kimberly, just got you taken care of. All right. Why do companies allow all endpoints to be tested? Why don't companies allow all endpoints to be tested? Threat actors don't follow a scope of engagement. So why don't companies act more realistically as well? Thanks, Eric. You know what, Marcus? That's been a griping massive point for me, especially in pen testing applications. So, like, when we did a lot of pen testing before, just pretty much focusing on DFIR aspect of things, you know, we would ask very basic questions like, okay, tell me a little, like, at a 30,000 foot view, a little bit about your organization. Tell me, you know, what you do not want us touching. And is there anything specific in your environment you really want to make sure we touch? After that, we don't ask any other questions. Everything is on us. We mimicked the mentality of a threat actor coming in. We would go through, we would do complete OSINTing, we would do complete discovery, we would do everything. Well, then it was just me. But, you know, I would go through that whole threat actor mentality, you know, from years of all the illegal crap I did, you know, but I would use those tools. I would go through and find those nuggets. I would find those GitHubs. I would find everything, right? And the little bit I've talked with now my newfound relationship with Black Hills, it seems like they have a lot of the same mentality as well, where they are taking it from a threat actor's perspective. So, you know, the canned things are just trash. They really, really are just trash. You know, it's like, that's why a lot of times when I would ask, if a customer would come to me or a prospect would come to me and say, hey, I need a pen test. All right. Are you looking to see what's actually vulnerable in your environment? Or are you just looking to check a box inside of your compliance? Because if you're just looking to check a box, we're one more expensive than the Rapid7, Nessus scans, whatever, or the least session of it anyway, for those one-offs that you can get from an MSP or IT vendor. But we're just not that type of organization, right? We're going to hammer the ever-living out of it, right? So, liquor, I don't even know. Oh my gosh. Next. Tim McDonald's. Yeah, dude, it's just the nature of the beast, right? So, it's just what happens, right? So, I do see things popping up in chat or in the mods. Thank you so much, mods, for keeping that going. Coffee also cleans the liver and some other things. I have a magnet on my refrigerator that says, coffee goes best with silence. Or instant human, just add coffee. Keith Sloan, because I haven't seen it in my feed here yet. Oh, here we are. Keith Sloan says, Eric, I am new to Team SC. Do you have your own content as well through Barricade? Yes, sir. Actually, I do. A lot of people do get scared because a lot of our the branding is just ransomware, because that's what I do for the most part. But if you just go to youtube.barricadecyber.com, it'll take you over to our YouTube channel in between now and the apocalypse. It'll ask you, hey, do you want to subscribe? Please subscribe. But Joe Dozier, I think, is actually beating me on subscribers, so I need to stomp him out a little bit. But anyway. But yeah, we got 205 videos. Some of it's pretty old. We're working on our Tabletop Thursdays. We've got a bunch of stuff that we're working on in the background. So this is when I was at my buddy JP's conference down in Texas. My big old McFat self there. Yeah, I do guest hosting here from time to time. My buddy Alan from Recorded Future, back when I actually wore a hat all the time from my old electrical days. Took me forever to get there, but yeah, got a bunch of the older Amplified and Intensified shows from John Witzel is at Recorded the Future, some CrowdStrike folks, things of that nature. So, and then I think, yeah, this is our, this is a throwback. It's not Thursday. But this is the first time that I got introduced to Dr. Gerald Auger. And you can see, let's see if I zoom in. Look at that young face. Look at that young face down there. If I can stop. There we go. So that's when I got introduced to him over 2 years ago. So anyway, yep. YouTube.barricadecyber.com. Go there for all the randomness. No, I was picking with you, Kerry. I was picking with you. I was playing back with you. You weren't doing anything wrong. Catching up in here. God for, going back to the coffee reference, God forbid I'd have to walk one floor. Yeah. But, dude, when you're set, those who don't know, when you're in InfoSec and you're in cybersecurity, there's so much chair time. Like, it's good to get up and go walk yourself, even if it is for more coffee. So. Luke, yes. That is right. So I'm just going to pivot over here to the mod chat. Gil's asking a couple questions. I'm not really sure how to answer, but the first one is, where can I find the best info about Modis and IEC protocols? I am not the guy for that, to be honest with you. Question two, where can I find SCADA emulators and trying some Wireshark and PT, not a real environment, just want to do some damage things. Sorry about that, getting Teams call in here. Y'all probably just heard that. I'm not big into the emulators. That's just not my forte, Gil. Question, story from Bleeping Computer regarding a game called Apex Legends. Oh, I seen something about that. Curious on your opinion, how it could be possible to hack players live, possible for any, thanks for any possible input. So, I saw something about this, and I don't know too much about it, because I was like, oh, gaming, whatever, I'll move on. But there used to be a way where you could look up people's IP addresses in the game and do DDoS attacks and things of that nature. I would have to read more on that story, Lorizzo Riviera, and get more information. Like I said, I've been under a rock. Super chat from Nerman. Hello, Mr. Taylor. Hello. Are you going to Las Vegas for DEF CON this summer? No, I am not going to DEF CON. Me going to DEF CON would probably be a bad thing. Yeah, I can say it. So, I've spent a lot of my years on the wrong side of the law growing up. Like, I was definitely that kid with that pen tester mentality of how far can I push that envelope before getting in trouble. And sometimes I pushed it way too far. So going to DEF CON right now, to me, is like putting beer in front of an alcoholic that's still going through the 12-step program, right? So it's, you know, I may do it once I'm a little bit more gray-haired, just to go and, you know, have fun and, you know, watch the kids play and stuff like that. But I think I've still got too much of the curiosity in me to start effing with stuff to go to DEF CON. That's why I kind of like Wild Hacking Fest, because, you know, there is that quote unquote safety harbor put in there. I heard about somebody that was trying to do Bluetooth attacks last year, and John Strand pretty much like, whoever it is, effing stop before, you know, we all pound you into the ground. So knowing that there's that line, right? That not to cross is not, you're, yes, there's people that are legitimately trying to lockpick and do penetration tests and stuff like that. And I know DEF CON has that, especially with your villages and stuff like that. There's allowed practices there. But people who know me know when I get bored, the gloves come off. So it's, yeah, but I will just definitely say it's definitely, it's like me being an, if I was an alcoholic going through a 12-step program to recover and walking and sitting up to the bar. So it's the way I would compare it. I just don't want to tempt myself, and I like my freedom, right? You know, there, I've got a lot of people who depend on me, so can't really be taking care of other people and my own family when I'm sitting behind bars. So, Keith Sloan, question for Eric. I got Doc's today. I got the Doc's take on this yesterday. I would like yours also. Would you recommend I start learning as someone new to IR? What? Maybe my ADHD is too strong. I got the Doc's take on this yesterday. Oh, Dr. Gerald Auger. Okay. I was thinking of like Word documents or PDF documents or something. I'm not sure why I didn't make that connection. Sorry. I would like yours also. What do you recommend, or what do you recommend I start learning as someone new to IR? Keith, I would say, I don't know too much about your history, but you know, if you have not been blue teaming, if you have not been on the network administration side, help desk, things of that nature, I would highly recommend you do that. I'm a massive advocate of you got to know what's good before you know what's evil, right? So, I do know that there is. So, I know Black Hills has, there's actually a course, and me and John Strand was actually talking about this in the pre-show banter, or the pre-show, before things went live. And a lot of you probably already know this stuff, right? But I was just talking to him about SANS and, you know, all the stuff, right? Oh, that's actually nice. Go back, hold on. I'm going to go ADHD moment here for a second here, ladies and gentlemen. Hold on. Go back. Where is this? Wow. So I know y'all seen a small version, but I got kind of... So I'm been messing with drone flights and stuff like that, and that's just awesome. Seeing pictures like that. But anyway. So, boom, learn. Oh, training, there it is. There is a... Security for MSPs, that's an oxymoron. Sorry. That is the opinions of me, Eric Taylor, not the... the host of Dr. Gerald Auger. So he clued me in on. Yeah, here we go. So Enterprise Forensics and Response. So if you haven't looked at this, this may be worth a look at, Keith as well. So. I have not taken this course, so I have no insights. There's been some courses that I have taken, and it looks like this one isn't available again until August 13th. So, be interesting. So if you've taken this one, definitely say something, you know, what was your experience with it? But I do know that SANS are Black Hills has been getting a lot of the veteran SANS instructors. So Black Hills is definitely, you know, getting up there in the ranks of some really, really good legitimate I mean, not saying that they weren't legitimate before, but you know, they're upping their game, right? Bear with me a second. It's been one of those nice. Sorry, getting some threat intel from the community. All right, so let's see. So Justin was said that when my dad was alive, he told my ex that he knew not to talk to him for the first hour I was awake or until two cups of coffee. Yeah, I feel you. Gary, I was attempting to apply for college here where I am in Texas for a bachelor's of cyber. Congratulations for making that effort, Carrie. When he tried to open the site, it was slower than my 13-year-old computer. I was like, there is no maintenance. Nope, there's not. Oh, Kimberly wants me to go on a rant. Hold on. We will go on a rant, huh? Because, ooh. Is everybody ready for ranting Thursday or ranting Tuesday? We're gonna do it. Where did my, there it is. Close that tab. Okay. So yeah, we were actually going through this a lot over the past couple of days. So this thing's going to drive me nuts. Bear with me one second, ladies and gentlemen. Like I said, I normally have, and of course, Joseph, I may have you making a phone call in a minute. Those who don't know, definitely check out uBlock Origin. It's definitely a decent, a pretty good blocker. Yay! See, 8 freaking things blocked. It's crazy. 9 freaking things blocked. That's nuts. But anyway, more than 133,000 Fortinet applications still vulnerable to month-old critical bug. You know what? Yes. Because people don't care unless it impacts them. And I guarantee you that we're going to get a bunch of calls here soon, because I know that there is a POC out. People are just slow to patch. They really, really are. And it's really, really bad. You know, it's a 9.6 out of a 10 severity. There's been a lot of unfortunate bugs with FortiGate that makes me want to go jump in a river. The number exposed SSL VPNs, you know. So the one thing that is a little funky, because a lot of people would be like, oh, well, it's SSL VPN. We don't have SSL VPN. Okay, that does minimize your exposure level, but the fact that you're not patching is still a very big problem. You know, there was that the Screen Connect vulnerability not too long ago. Do you know there is still, I think, over 50,000 Screen Connect servers that are out there right now that still are not patched? I mean, people are just, and that is, to me, an MSP's high heaven to actually, you know, compromise environments. It's really, really, really bad. So the fact that they're just not doing it, I don't understand why. I really, really don't understand. Right? I mean, I understand change management. I understand rollbacks, and I understand all these things. Speaking of change management, let me check on PCW. Okay, cool. So 1,000 of it. Okay. Yeah, so like yesterday, even last night, we have a client that I had to go through. They have a site-to-site VPN, FortiGate, and you know, we were dropping packets every so often, randomly. No errors that we could see in the logs. So last night I went in, made backups of the complete configuration, blew out the SSL VPN, or the site-to-site VPN for IPsec, rebuilt it. The new version actually made it a lot quicker. It was normally an hour process. I got started like 10 minutes before 9 last night, and I think I was done in like 20 minutes, 25 minutes, and it normally is an hour process at least. So, but you know, a lot of these software updates are allowing quicker adoption to be able to get things done. So, you know, not getting your stuff patched is not just a vulnerability management issue, but it can also be a massive feature being able to get there. This one here is the flaw in FortiGate client endpoint management service. We don't have, I've been toying with doing this, but I think this is just adding another layer. So those who don't know the endpoint management service, it's like a mobile device manager, I guess the first M. Yeah, mobile device manager, which they do apply to Windows systems. I don't know why, but whatever. But it does. It's an application that sits there, and it will communicate back to a management system that will do for like patching and things of that nature. And this is just adding another service onto something that we've already got in there. So no need to buy more stuff to, you know, take care of stuff that you're already paying stuff for, right? So but yeah, it's, you know, this is just another story of the week that, you know, they are, they're just going through the rounds of, you know, vulnerabilities, trying to get things patched. They're on the quote unquote front lines, if you will. So we've seen Zyrtec do it, we've seen QNAP, Synology, you know, all these, they go through their cycles, right? So don't throw out the baby with the bathwater on this one. It's, you know, when you're thinking about QNAP and Synology, probably the QNAPs, you probably want to throw the baby out with the bathwater on that one, because there's just non-stop all year long with more and more vulnerabilities. So let me get caught up here. Oh, so thanks for the correction, DJ BSEC. So Modbus is all ICS stuff. See, I don't mess with ICS. He said that you can definitely check out this resource. Who was asking about that a moment ago? So Gil, if you're still here, Mod DJ BSEC said you can check out this resource here, and I'll drop it into the chat. Did my edge just tank out on me? There it goes. It comes back. So I just dropped that in chat. So you can definitely check out this one. I didn't know Modbus is what it was called. So I literally thought for some reason you were talking about emulators. So my apologies for not knowing that terminology. Master HM. Wow. This is actually some kind of cool stuff. So go away. Huh. Thanks, DJ BSEC, for correcting me and helping me expand some terminology that I was not previously aware of. I mean, I know Modbus, so the ICS typically has their own own network internally, much like relays and switches and things like that. You know, more of control, system control aspect, not like your access control and automation relays and switches and stuff like that, not like your 12-port switch or anything. So it's got its own type of thing that it deals with and works with. So normally the controllers are what's actually tied to the actual physical network, plus your heads-up display, your HUDs, things of that nature. But again, it's, I know enough about it and played with it enough in some water treatment facilities to kind of understand the overall how it kind of works, but I am definitely no master at it by any means. So again, Gil, if you're still here, hopefully maybe DJ BSEC was able to drop that in there. Apex, Justin Gold said Apex is a game. Yes, there's apparently a RCE flaw. Yeah, let's dig into that. Again, I seen it on my feed, and I seen it as a game, and I'm like, okay, it doesn't apply, I don't care. We typically don't allow, you know, Steam, and, you know, we fuss at them about that and Roblox and stuff like that being on freaking company-owned devices, so... let's see, Apex, RCE, POE, or proof of POC. Oh, everybody's favorite thing, Reddit. Bear me, so I'm just kind of scanning this thing. So, GSGO, is this the game we're talking about? I mean, the graphics look kind of cool. Is it a first-person shooter? I might. And is it available for Xbox? Might be a cool game after they fix those vulnerabilities. Oh, look, we even have potential the remote code execution on here. Let's see. Oh, Counter-Strike. So Apex is a different game than Counter-Strike, right? Someone, see, I'm showing, oh, that's not good. So you launch Counter-Strike and it's able to exit. So that's part of, yeah, Steam. Yeah. I think I'm looking at the wrong thing though. That could extend and all easy into cheat. Yeah. So this is a Oh, thank you. Thanks, Joseph. I love you. So Joseph is setting me straight because, you know, I'm old and a boomer. So Apex Legends Pro ruined by unique live hack. So apparently this is, you know, some game hacks or whatever.
I'm getting hacked, but...
I know it's true. Can you play the game?
Bro, I'm getting hacked.
I know, but can you play?
Yeah, but it's cheating. The fuck?
I know.
Let's turn it off. So I guess somebody's taking over their screen or whatever. Or taking over their gameplay. Okay. Stop being a cheater. Anyway. Anything else anybody wants to talk about? What the heck is this? The curse of convenience, where does it all end? That is hilarious! Have y'all seen what is that thing? I know it's been around for a while, but apparently it's kept making a comeback where you just lay in bed all day. Ooh, Alienware. Love it, love it, love it. Gary, this sounds like something that, Haircut Fish should put together. What is the resolution on the second screen? I don't know. I know it's an LG wide. It's not the curved, but it's a wide screen. It's wide enough that way when I'm building my timeline for my cases, I can be able to have, you know, all the information in an Excel sheet put up there. So does your drone know where it isn't? Probably not. Mine actually hasn't. So I've messed with a lot of drones, and Joseph actually was talking about his drone for a while there, and he's got one of the big name brands. I'm not sure if I really should say which one, but you know, I always had a problem with drones and things like that, not being able to control it, but you know, got a hold of this one, and it might be the Fisher Price of it, whatever, of drone flights or whatever, but it's freaking cool. I love it. There's a free drone cert here that one of the colleges get certified for. Oh, that's pretty cool. I know there's I don't know how much it is now, but there's some. There's been a lot of businesses looking for licensed drone operators, and I'm not sure if they're looking for, you know, stuff that can do like the DJI versions, or do you need like one of the bigger, badder freaking ones, or what? I don't know. And I'm not talking about like the minis, like even the commercial drones from DJI, or if you need like just a bigger one. AdCord, okay. I'll have to take a look at that. Just catching up on the mod chat here. So what, Eric, what from Carrie? Sorry, I'm still trying to get caught up in the... See if I can quickly find Carrie's thing so I can bring it up. Here it is. So why is it hard to get the attention of companies? I applied to a company that said you need a bachelor's or a 0-2 experience or a remote SOC. And as usual, I didn't hear anything back. Carrie, I really think right now, I mean, we've talked about this before, not to you specifically, but we've talked about this in generalizations, but we're seeing a lot of uncertainty in the market, right? So if you don't know about this, layoffs.fyi, come here to a larger version. But yeah, I mean, we're seeing, I mean, you can just see day after day after day after day after day. I mean, like Deadspin, I'm not sure what the heck this thing is, but 100% layoff. So they just, oh, they got acquired. Yeah, however, I guess 11 people potentially laid off, which was their whole company because they got acquired. You know, EA's got 680 from two, three weeks ago. Sony, I mean, it's only 8%, but that's 900 people. You know, so there's a lot of stuff in the industry right now where we still have the battle of, are we going to allow remote workers? Are we going to do mandate come back to the office? Are we going to offer a hybrid? That is still very much a conversation that we're hearing in the tech space, because we know a lot of companies that still are paying for leased office space that are just collecting dust. Now, there can be an argument there that, you know, that's just a company expense and, you know, you just got to wait till your lease ends and, you know, you can just cancel out of that. And that's a fair argument. But it's one of those things, like, let's say hypothetically you just bought a brand new vehicle that's sitting out in the driveway and it sits there for 4 months. You don't go anywhere in it. You still take your car around or whatever the case is. You know, what's the point of having something if you're not going to utilize it? So, I mean, I see both sides of the coin on that one. And when you see things like this right here, I imagine, you know, everybody's looking at, you know, metrics like this, not maybe specifically this site, but when you're looking at stuff like this and you look at, you know, potential stuff going on with the stock market and you look at all these different variables, long story short, there is a metric F-ton of uncertainty in our economy, period. And I do think, I seen a report not too long ago where there are people that are just, they're still putting out, oh, so there was a potentially a tinfoil hat thing, but there's speculation that there are some states that are putting out resumes or putting out job applications and never filling them to make it look like they are looking for active talent. They can't find it, so they get subsidies. I've heard of that being a scenario. I have, again, tinfoil hat. I have not tracked that down. Is it a legitimate actual thing? I don't know, right? So that's one thing. And then you got the other side of it of, you know, how easy is it just to post a job ad these days, right? So there's a lot of stuff going on right now. I wouldn't say it's you. I just think there's so much going on that it's hard to know exactly what is going on. What is people expecting? You know, I don't know. It's a weird time. It really, really is. So, you know, it depends on what news channel you're watching. Either the economy is great or it effing sucks. I don't know. All I know is everything costs more where I live. So. All right, switch over here to mod chat. So Rizzo, I guess the issue is the integrity of the gaming, of the competitive gaming going out the window due to the hack. Yeah, I mean, how many games? So hold on. I'm going to try to solve my lack of knowledge real quick. Is Apex Legends okay, so Apex Legends is a game made by EA. Okay. I didn't know if it was like Fortnite. Well, I think Fortnite's made by EA or something too. But, okay. Okay, so that clarifies that in my head. But yeah, I mean, there's one thing you gotta remember, and people need to take this thing with a grain of salt, is if man made it, man can break it. So, and the games are supposed to be fun. So if you're not having fun, get off the game. Well, maybe that's just old boomer dude talking, but it's whatever. James Lynch, you should probably use VLAN security for that stuff before connecting a gateway to a normal net. Yeah. VLAN's for life, dude. VLAN's for life, James Lynch. Jayfish said, I had a job interview last Monday. It went very well. They said I'd be a great fit when I asked if they had any reservations. I already sent my follow-up and still haven't heard anything. What do I do? Jayfish, I would gently keep nudging him. I wouldn't do an everyday thing, but once a week. Definitely, you know, maybe have it set up for, you know, in Outlook to send it at a certain time. You know, let's say 8:05 to make it look like it's not a completely automated self or timed email to go out. So Fortnite is epic. Okay. Sorry, I'm just not a huge gamer, guys. But anyway, I would just keep following up. I would send one email and one phone call. Yeah, I would take the old salesman mentality. I know it's, everybody hates that salesman that constantly berates you, but you're looking for a job to take care of yourself and or your family and the people that may depend on you. I would say be gentle about it, but gently nudging. Yeah, so they're getting an email, they're getting a voicemail or whatever from you. You're being persistent. I think they're either going to tell you to, you know, that you're hired or you're died, right? And you're no longer part of it. So I would hunt it down, but that's just me, right? I'd like to get to an absolute result, if at all possible. And I think a job application is definitely something that could be hunted down to that. All right, so one or two more quick questions because I have missed a couple of phone calls I do need to get back to. So, okay. Yeah, I'm the same way. I mean, we're really small. I'm pretty picky, I think. Yeah, I want to make sure that the candidate that's going to come in is going to be a good fit for the organization, right? I don't want to bring someone in that's going to cause conflict, or I believe conflict. They're a smaller company. I would be a little bit more gentle. Don't try to alienate them. But I do believe, you know, when I think back in my old high school days, when I was trying to get a job, that's what I did. I showed that I wanted the job. And that helped me get hired 9 times out of 10. I'm trying to think if there was anything else. And I think just people going back to the true personality and building a connection with somebody, I think that's the best thing to do. I mean, if they're a playful organization, you could do that. Could, you know this company better than any of us in this chat, right? But, you know, if they were a more playful organization, y'all were cutting it up in the interviews and y'all, you have that rapport, definitely make a little bit of a humorous thing out of it if you can, right? And that'd definitely be more than like just saying, hey, I know you're busy, but I'm just following up, you know, so yeah. All right, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. Sorry it wasn't as structured, but it's definitely, you know, kind of on par for me, just kind of shooting the trash with you guys. I greatly appreciate it, and we will talk to y'all next time. Until then, stay curious, my friends.
Once was a kid whose passwords laid across all sites. They were the same, a criminal, then found their fame by taking that data to go.
Soon may a criminal come to steal your pictures and data and run. One day when the crime is done, they'll steal your account and go.
If you enjoyed that content, keep the cybersecurity train going by connecting with the other Simply Cyber community resources. We have the Discord server that's lively and always keeps the conversation going. You can connect with me directly on LinkedIn. And also every single weekday morning on the Simply Cyber channel, we're doing live daily cyber threat briefings, 8 a.m. Eastern time, as well as Thursday at 4:30 p.m. we're doing live stream interviews with industry experts, and we produce videos that we push out every Wednesday morning. I'm Jerry from Simply Cyber. I hope you enjoyed the content, and we'll see you in the next one.
Get out of here, you filthy animal.